What's up, everybody? Unfortunately, I'm not gonna have enough time to visit Kerala during this trip to India, so I'm gonna do the next best thing. I'm gonna get me some Kerala food in New Delhi. Now, I did extensively travel through Kerala on a previous trip to India, and I loved its food, its people, and its landscapes, and right about now, I wanna try to recreate that magic. Somehow, someway, for a brief moment, I wanna feel like I'm back inside Kerala. I wanna feel like I'm deep inside that buck wild Indian state. Suffice to say, I ordered myself a serious Keralan feast, and I was getting pretty excited to try it out. So first up, I figured I'd go for this mean poli chathu. Yeah, I'm probably not pronouncing that correctly, but no harm, no foul, baby. Lucky for me, India is a free country, and no one's gonna cut your dick off if you mispronounce a food word. Anyway, I was trying my best to get inside that banana leaf, but it was being a tad uncooperative with me. Nevertheless, slowly but surely, I was making my way into that banana leaf, and oh, man, check that out. Holy shit. What we got here are some fishy wishies that have been steamed up in a banana leaf. Seems to me like we got a whole lot of spices and vegetables steamed up in there as well, and it looks like it has some serious swadished potential. So I figured that right about now I might as well load the boat with a little bit of rice, Kerala rice to be exact. Apparently this is some kind of indigenous species of rice grown in Kerala, and I think it's safe to say playtime is over, baby cakes. Now, I know what you're saying, it's just rice, right? Well, to me, it's so much more. After spending 3 years living in Japan, I've learned to love the rice, and I've learned to live with the rice. What can I say? I've learned to appreciate some high-quality grainage over the years, and I guess you could say I'm a rice connoisseur of sorts. But hey, I'm getting a tad off-topic over here. The main thing is, I decided I'd best be digging into that fishy-wishy. So I started savagely and animalistically digging into that fishy-wishy like the very existence of mankind depended on it. And whoa, 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 holy shit, I think I just mauled that fishy-wishy to kingdom come. What's this, amateur hour? I just expended all that effort and I only got one damn tomato on my plate. Lucky for me, one of the maestros working at the place started to help me out. I think you could probably see I was a tad out of my element with this whole banana leaf situation. And I must say, not only was it pretty heartwarming that he decided to help me out, but it was also pretty dick-warming. And whoa, baby, this maestro's on a roll over here. He's dishing out that prawns mango curry for me as well. Seems to me like this food maestro's got my best interests at heart, and I think it's safe to say that that right there is a nice fucking maestro. Anyway, after I thanked that maestro from the bottom of my heart, I started inspecting that food, and it was looking real good. So I started digging into that mean poli chathu, aka Keralan fishy wishy masala. And truth be told, my heart was pumping full fucking throttle and there was sweat on my brow at the mere thought of eating that fishy wishy. Yet despite a shaky hand and some crazed physiological impulses popping off in my body, I eventually was able to get some fishy. I got some rice on that fork too, and then I took myself a bite and, oh, man. Holy fucking masala, dogs, that was a delectable bite. Here we got some steamed tomato, curry leaves, a whole lot of spices, and some coconut action in this puppy. Now, as if that wasn't buck wild enough on its own, that fishy wishy was tasting tender to the max and juicy as hell. It seems to me like steaming that food in a banana leaf helped it to retain all its moisture. That's a pretty damn zesty cooking technique in my book, and I think it's safe to say that fishy wishy has achieved its life purpose. I mean, generally speaking, I don't think that most fishy wishies want to meet a premature death by the hands of a human. They probably want to swim and frolic in the open seas, living wild and free, but in this case, I think even the most stubborn fishy-wishy would make an exception. I mean, just look at this fucking swadished dish. What fishy-wishy wouldn't be proud to be a part of it? Can you tell me that? Truth of the matter is, this achahe fish flesh is tasting so damn good that I'm losing my tenuous grip on reality. So after polishing off that mofo, you best believe I moved on to that mango prawns curry. And with a wily, crazed gleam in my eye, I punctured that prawn and then I shoved it down my throat. And holy coachy, oh my moonar, that was a paradigm-shifting bite. That soft, succulent, shrimpy wimpy tasted like some coconut milk, some sour, unripened mango, a whole lot of spices, and maybe even just a pinch of sugar. And I gotta tell ya, sweetie buns, with each passing bite, I was losing my damn mind with this buck wild meal. Hell, even that Kerala rice was top notch. Those grains of rice were pretty big, soft, and moist, strange as that may sound. I mean, my G from Japan told me all about it. Different species of rice have different moisture levels. And while most types of rice in Japan are pretty wet, most types of rice in India are pretty dry, except for this one. I guess it all comes down to personal preference, though. Do you like your rice dry and dirty, or do you like it wet and wild, baby? Anyway, after I finished off that plate, that maestro started dishing off even more fish onto my plate. That maestro was getting into it, and I felt like he was loving life over there. Seems to me like this food maestro knows how to carpe the fuck out of the diem. He's spooning out that mean poli chathu with a joyous demeanor, and I could swear that damn rascal had a twinkle in his eye. Man, oh man, that food maestro's in the zone, baby. He's got a zest and finesse as if he's ballroom dancing with life itself. This zen-ass maestro seems to have his finger on the pulse of the universe, and he's dishing out that food with the self-assured confidence of a glorified god. Anyway, after that magical food maestro finished his work, I moved on to this apam. And I think when I was digging into that banana leaf in the beginning, I got some of that fish gravy on there, but I'm moving on with my life. I ripped off a piece of that apam for myself and was kinda surprised at how soft and spongy it was. Then I got myself a choice quality chunk of fishy wishy and put it onto the apam. And you'll probably never guess the next step, but I actually started to wrap that fish into the apam. Then I feverishly brought that chunk of food dangerously towards my head, and I looked at it for but a moment, then I took myself a bite. And holy mother of masala dogs, what was that? What the fuck was that? Was that a life-changing bite right there? Because I think it actually was. That spongy as hell soft bread was porous to the max, and it actually soaked up all those fish juices. Somehow, some way, it felt like that damn bread temporarily fused to that fish, and I was loving it. In fact, come to think of it, that individual bite was actually a 6 out of 5 Maharaja Dogs. What can I say? It was just that fucking good. So I tried that bread out with a little shrimp action, and it was looking pretty decent. Then I took myself a bite, and oh, man. That was a decent bite, but I think that fish works better because it's much softer and therefore it can actually fuse to the bread. Long story short, those are some pretty spiritually enlightening flavor combos, if I do say so myself. Anyway, I continued to barrel full steam ahead with this meal and I started trying out this Kerala paratha over here, but I wasn't too into it. The damn thing was too hard to tear apart and almost too hard to wrap, and it's not even really worth mentioning. I also continued to chow down on some incredible pieces of mango like this and some life-affirming pieces of shrimp like that. And before I knew it, I had polished off just about everything in sight. But of course, no meal is complete without a sweet motherfucking treat. So I figured I'd get myself some caramelized banana with a little ice cream action. And wow, just wow, take a look at that. The mere sight of that food is spiking my blood sugar, and I have a feeling it's spiking everyone else's around me at the same fucking time. So I got myself some ice cream and put it on top of that piece of banana next to it, and then I got ready to shove it toward my head. And the exact fraction of a nanosecond that I bit down on that banana, I was kinda surprised. This wasn't really a banana, actually, it was a plantain, baby. That plantain is kinda like a banana, but it's much harder and much less sweet than a banana is. Basically, this dessert is pretty good, but I think plantains are more suitable for savory dishes, at least that's my opinion. So with all that considered, if I had to rate this meal as a whole, I think I would definitely give it a 5 out of 5 Maharaja Dogs. I mean, there were amazing parts of the meal and there were not so amazing parts of the meal, but the sum total was pretty damn good. Oh, and by the way, if you want to see even more life-enhancing Indian food tours, then you best be checking out my other videos. I got a video about a Buck Wild deli buffet, and I got a video about Bihari foods, just to name a few. I've got those links in the description box. And as always, thanks for watching this video. Why don't you leave a comment? Let me know what you think.